All right, welcome to this web lecture on the use of voice applications and voice XML. So in this lecture, we'll talk a bit about what voice applications are, what the web standard voice XML does, and I'll show you some examples, some Hello World examples for using voice XML. All right, so let's go to the screen. So voice XML, these slides were voice XML slides were developed by initially by people from the World Wide Web Foundation, including Max von Manten and Deborah Dahl, and some extensions are more recent. Okay, so what are voice applications? So voice applications are applications that are accessed by telephone. So we're not talking about let's say smartphone applications that have a voice component, but really applications that can be reached by dialing a phone number. And applications that then provide information to the user by voice. So not through images or anything on the screen, but really by talking back to the user. And the user has two ways of inputting information, either by using the keypad, telephone keypad, so 1 to 9, the pound sign and the star, or by speaking. So why would you want these things? So we've talked a little bit about this in the HCI lecture, of course. Benefits of a speech application is that it can be accessed by any telephone. So there's no, let's say, versioning of Android that you need to take care of, or figuring out if people need an iOS device or have an older phone. So any phone that can make a normal phone call can reach a voice application. And it sort of works on this infrastructure that is very prominently available in large parts of the world. So next reason is that speaking and listening are natural usage modes for phones, right? So they're the usual way that people use phones anyway. So in that sense, having an application that is very close to the way people use phones anyway is one barrier lesser for using this. And you can also combine automated tools, automated applications with actual people on the phone. Right, so that's what you have a lot when you, for example, call your doctor. So if I call my doctor, I get a quick voice menu where I have to make a few choices. And then if I make the choice 4, which is just connect me to a person, the application will just forward my call to an actual person who can help me out. Right, so that's a very nice way of integrating the two things. So how can we build voice applications? So there's a few different ways. There's all kinds of proprietary software, very nice ones that have GUIs and etc. There are some common languages which are accessible through all kinds of proprietary APIs. We're not going to look at those either. There's all kinds of scripts and low-level scripting languages, Asterisk, which is used a lot. But we look at the web standard for things, right? So this is something that we have been doing a lot at VU, looking at web standards for developing applications, and voice XML is the standard for these kind of voice applications. All right, so voice applications are nice, but and you can see how they have analogies to the visual web, right? Where in the visual web, users access an application through a browser and a URL. In the voice web, people call a phone number, and then they get to that specific application that is associated with that phone number rather than with a URL. In the visual web, the browser makes an HTTP request to the server, right? And in the voice web, the voice browser, the thing you call, makes an HTTP request to some voice XML page, right? So HTML and voice XML are analogous in this scenario. In the visual web, the browser, the application you have on your computer or on your phone, takes the generated or the received HTML page and visualizes that in an appealing and usable site. And in the voice web, the voice XML browser takes the voice XML that is somewhere and then presents it as a dialogue, turns it into audio, which then is sent to the user over the phone channel. The visual web, well, then application has space and time to work with. So you have time, but you also have a lot of space. Most notably the visual space that is on your screen. And in the voice web, we have just the time signal, right? So that's a big difference in usability. Well, that leads to all kinds of limitations of voice applications. So I'll give you like a minute to think about it. Please pause the video and just think about what doesn't work about voice applications. So I hope you thought about it for a second. And there's obviously some things that voice applications are not really good at. As for example, conversational bandwidth is just a much lower. So for those of you who followed the lecture I did years ago on web accessibility, people that have, for example, that use screen readers to browse the web, they can do that quite comfortably, but it takes much longer, but just because the bandwidth is a lot lower in terms of how much information can I present to the user in any given time period. Well, all information that's there has to be spoken to the user, so there's no other way of conveying information to the user other than through audio, right? So in the web, you have video, you have images, you have icons, you have colors, you have text, and all kinds of different modalities. Here we just have audio. Right, and information that comes from the user also is quite limited, so it can only be communicated through key presses or through voice, and therefore the user input options are quite limited. So for which type of applications is a voice service useful? Well, again, you can think about this, and it's quite obvious. So for things that don't need, for example, alphabetic input, because you don't have a keyboard to do this. You don't want to have applications in very noisy environments where it's very hard to hear system prompts. You don't want to have applications that are, you know, the only way that you can interact with them is if they have a graphical display, etc. There's all kinds of reasons why some applications are not really suitable for these kind of technologies. So if you build these things, take this into account. Applications take place in time, so they take a long time for people to navigate through. Users cannot see what the application wants them to do, even though if you have a very clear view of what your application does, for the user, they just get the audio input. Users cannot see what they did, so it's very hard to have these breadcrumb type things in voice applications. And users can also can't see what the system thought that they did, so it's very hard to develop systems that give appropriate feedback. So anytime you have these sort of human-computer interaction type considerations about usability, here in voice applications, they're even stronger than in normal web applications. Okay, so let's go to a Hello World example. Right, so this is the Hello World of a voice XML application. So we see here that there is an XML declaration. And then we see these VXML tags. So for those of you who have not XML, well, I'll explain a little bit later. But and then there's basically a bunch of administrative tags. And in the end, we see here Hello World. Now, what the application does is once you call it, it will actually hopefully pronounce Hello World. So let's try. I've actually had this application run somewhere at Foxio Evolution, which we'll talk about in a second. And there's an associated phone number with it, so you can actually call it yourself. And because we didn't have a paid service, we actually have a free service which requires us to enter a PIN number. So let's see if this works. I'll get my phone out. So I call this this number that I just showed. Let's see if we can put it on speaker.
Welcome to Voxeo's Developer Network. To test your application, say or key in your application PIN.
Right, so that was quite spectacular, I think. So after entering the PIN, which is needed to access the specific application that I was developing, it just says Hello World. Right, so not super exciting, I admit, but this is the most simple thing. And I think as computer scientists, we all develop a Hello World example. All right, so let's continue. So what's actually happening here? So like we said, in a normal browser on the web, the user uses a web browser to access through HTML some web content that's out there somewhere. And in this case, the user, which was me, I used the normal phone system to call actually a system, so that's here, which then accesses a piece of content that's somewhere, right? So in this case, there is this Hello World content. It's accessed by a voice XML browser, which has all these nice features of generating phone numbers and these PIN codes. And then I just called it and I got the audio back. Right, and you can even develop systems, just going back one slide, you can even develop systems that access the same information through these different channels, right? So we can have the same content here and have different ways of accessing it. And that's very useful in these kind of scenarios. Okay. So in this case, the voice browser is hosted on an external cloud service. There's also solutions that have your voice browser on your own PC, right? So you can then access the same information and do that through an audio link on your PC. So that's not what we're going to talk about much, but that's possible. All right, so basic terms in voice applications. So we have a call flow. That's basically just the setup of a voice application, right? So it's basically the tree. So if you choose one, you go there. If you choose two, you go there. A dialogue is the back and forth between the user and the system. So asking for a prompt and then getting a return. System outputs are prompts. So the hello world you just heard was a prompt. So basically just something that the system says to you. And then you have user input. And user input can be 1, 2, 3, 4 choices, or they can be defined by grammars, which allow you to enter specific types of things. For example, cities, right? So I can have a list of cities, and then I can try to match the user input through voice recognition to this pre-listed set of options. And it can be slightly more complex. So I can, for example, define a grammar to get postal codes in the Netherlands, where I expect 4 numbers and then 2 letters. All right. So this is an example of a call flow. It's just a drawing of what happens. In this case, it's for a simple service that allows the caller to receive the scores for a team, a football team. Right, and this is another way of writing down a call flow in which there's slightly more information. So all of these give roughly the same information about how your application works. And remember, this is something that the user does not see. So the user does not know what the different options are until you tell the user. But, okay, so we'll be using mostly this, so a voice browser on the web that accesses some information somewhere. So the nice thing about this is that we can actually use all kinds of server-side processing tricks to build more interactive applications, right? So because a voice XML page as an HTML document can be generated by these server-side scripts, you can actually build quite complex applications that take the user input, do something with it in PHP, generate a voice XML page that is then served to you. Right? That's something that's nice to have. And you can use JSP, PHP servlets, etc. It depends on the server where you are hosting this. Okay, so like I said, we will be looking at voice XML. So this is a W3C recommendation since 2004, so it's a standard. If you Google it, you can quite easily go to this page where you see the entire specification, all kinds of examples, and the way that's being used. And you see that it's a sort of this combination of people from industry and research. But it's very well supported by different parties here. Right, so Voice XML is an XML language, as you have seen. So that means that all elements are surrounded by these tags just in HTML, and you can actually nest tags, right? So HTML is, or XML is not a very difficult way of writing down code, but you just have to make sure that you sort of comply to these XML standards. So you have these tags, and then elements can have attributes as well. They're denoted like this. And we're not going to go into too much detail because I don't know the background of all of you. So I hope that you'll be able to either within your assignment teams or by going to the lab lectures, you can have some way of debugging these things and figuring out what works and what doesn't. In HTML, the top construct is HTML, and in voice XML, the top construct is VXML. So that's basically the beginning and the end of your document. And then you have two types of applications, your forms and menus. So these are, let's say, the high-level constructs. And they're slightly different, although in practice, you can use both types of things for most of the types of interactivity that you want. So you can use menus when you want to list a bunch of options to users. And then, for example, have them choose 1, 2, 3, 4 to go to different sections in your application. And you can define forms that ask for all kinds of input for a specific field. So this is like an HTML form. So part of a dialog system says something using a prompt element, just like the hello world we just said, and the user then replies with speech or key presses. And a sequence like this is called a turn, right? The dialog consists of different turns. And then the system usually does something based on the user's input. So either it submits data to the server, transfers you to another part in the application, transfers a call, executes a script, can be all kinds of things that's happening. Right, so let's have a look again at this. Right, here we see the form, and then within the form there's apparently a block thing, which is a sort of a grouping of elements. And then we have a prompt, which means, you know, use text to speech to pronounce this. And depending on the server, it will use some voice. So usually on the server, you can select whether you want a male or a female voice, whether you want to have an American pronunciation or a British pronunciation or a French pronunciation or anything like that. So that's all handled by the specific text-to-speech engine of the server. So that's nice, but if we don't want to use text-to-speech but pre-recorded audio, we can also do that. Right, so instead of having in the prompt a text file which is then to be interpreted by the voice browser as the text-to-speech action, we can also add an audio file directly. And that audio file can be on the same server, as is implied here, or it can be a URL which is somewhere else. Right, so you can use your voice application, you can use information from all over the web. And if the WAV file complies to the standards that are expected by the server, then actually this will work perfectly. Okay, so why would you want to have recorded audio? So that's quite interesting. So for one reason, you can use any voice you like, right? So if you use pre-recorded audio, you can use the voice that people are familiar with or the voice that has the features that you want. And we have actually been using that also in the voices applications that you've seen in the previous video, right? In Radio Mechier, for example. So text-to-speech is also very nice and, of course, much more versatile. You don't have to record all the different prompts, but that only works if you have a text-to-speech for the specific language, right? So that's only for roughly 20, maybe next year's 50 languages, but the majority of languages will not have this option. So that means that pre-recorded audio is something that is in an ICT for development context you have to sort of consider. And you can actually combine them, right? So you can this works perfectly fine. Okay, so some other constructs in voice XML, you can have these go-to statements, right? Within a form, you can have a pronunciation and you have a go-to statement, which can then point you to another document, right? So that means you can actually structure your application in multiple documents. And you can, within document, you can also use tags, just as you would do in HTML. Okay, so we need to talk a little bit about user input. So we talked now about how to generate prompts, but user input, as we said, can be through key presses or voice. So key presses are quite useful. They're called DTMF tones. So these are the tones that you hear when you press a button. So we can hopefully listen to them now. Oh, no, that doesn't work. Right, so every tone has a specific frequency which is recognized on the other side. So actually in the most simple case, the frequency of the audio is being processed at the end. And what you can actually do is just to mimic the frequency using like a flute or something, and it should also work. But you know, you can try that yourself. Right. So why are key presses useful? Because they are very discrete entry points, and they are very useful for noisy environments. You don't have to take into account people's accents or their weird phones that are very have a very bad audio quality, etc. So very useful. So if you ask a user, please press 1 for this, or please enter your age, then you would always want to do DTMF, basically, because it's so much easier. One downside that we have found is that people, when using DTMF, they have to sort of take their phone from their ear and then input information like this and then put it back. So you might, you know, you have to make sure that you don't lose them in this interaction. So that's something that we just find in applications where there's a lot of input and back and forth. People don't do this normally, right? So for people that have never used voice applications, this is something that is often sort of a hurdle to get over. And from a usability perspective, it's something you can design for. All right. So that's key presses. And then, of course, there's also, as I said, speech recognition. So this is where you actually say something, and then the application can try to process it, or will process it, and use automatic speech recognition to analyze the user's speech and try to determine what kind of words were spoken. So this is, of course, much more natural. And again, you don't have to use sort of remove the phone from your ear. But it's much less accurate and also quite complex to write these speech recognition systems. So in many cases, we are actually expecting that if you want the system to understand what the user is doing, so to actually process the input and do something based on that, then you usually use key presses. If you just want to have, let's say, a recording, for example, if you want to say record a message, then of course you can use speech recognition because the system doesn't have to do anything at runtime. Right, so DTMF is useful for noisy environments, for privacy reasons, for entering numbers, if you don't have speech recognizers in that language. So that's mostly what we'll focus on in this class. But more in general, speech recognition is useful for, well, for example, if you have long lists, I didn't tell you that before, but if you have a very long list, longer than 10 items, of course you don't want to use, you know, press 1-6, because then, you know, when is it the 1-6 and when is it the 1? When you want multiple pieces of information at once, or to reduce memory load for the user. So in some cases, speech recognition might be actually helpful here. All right, so yeah, so these are some more elements. I'm not going to spend too much time on this because you can actually see that in the specification. But this is what, for example, a slightly more complex application looks like. And within the form things, you can actually have these fields, right, where you would have prompts that take as an attribute what kind of type of input from the user is expected. So in this case, a form, like in HTML, where you could also have a form with a limited number of options, here you would have a form and a specific type that is expected. And here, in this case, there's a built-in grammar for this question. So the question that you will hear is, would you like to be famous? And the application then waits for input from the user in this form. Right, and if it hears something but it doesn't recognize it, it will say so. If it hears something and recognizes it, can map it to one of these words, it will process it and then say, for example, if one of these things is yes, so let's say yes and okay are matched to one, sorry, then it will trigger this if condition, and otherwise it will trigger this else condition. So that's one way in which you can do form processing. Right, and then of course people can say something and you have no idea what's happening, or someone is completely silent and you have these no input and no match things. Right, so for example, for no input, someone is silent, you don't hear anything. Well, you can say, okay, well, I didn't hear anything, just okay, to be sure, press it or enter again, or we can actually give you another option. So in this case, it's a combination of doing first voice input through this prompt, and then if it doesn't work, we can actually have this 1-2 thing, which is actually also processed by the same built-in grammar. And then there's no match, so if I say excuse me, then I would say, oh, I don't know, I don't recognize this word, so let's go, yeah, well, I will explain it a bit better. Okay. So that's it for now, and I'll in the next video I'll do a quick demonstration on how Foxio Evolution works. Thank you.